Hey everybody, this is Greg Brown, and this video is going to be about ear modeling inside of Modo. This topic was asked for a couple times during the Henning competition, and I am just now getting around to recording this video because, well, it is a fairly long topic to record a video for. So for that reason, let's just go right ahead and get moving on this. And first thing I want you to notice is right here on the sides of the heads, I have cut holes out of my base mesh that I've created. And the reason for this is going to be where the ear actually attaches to the side of the head. Next thing I'm going to do is I'm going to create an ear plane that is going to be responsible for kind of outlining what kind of form my ear is going to take at its furthest extent, if that makes any sense. Fortunately, showing definitely does a much better job of explaining. So I'm creating a plane right here, and symmetry is on, so I want to move that out to the side of the head, just select as a poly, and in the orthographic views kind of start moving this poly into an orientation that maybe might make more sense for an ear. So I'll just kind of angle that outward a little bit. And right now, if you'll notice, I'm using Action Center Local, which aligns to the local normal of the object, in this case, the polygon. And it's very helpful for tweaking some of your shapes and forms. And that's a very, very rough generic shape we've got there. And so I'm going to subdivide faceted once just to keep the shape of the square. And then just do a regular subdivide without faceted, a STS subdivide. And I am going to go back to the sculpt tools. And it looks to me like, yeah, that is flipped. So I'm going to flip that polygon around. It's brighter on this side. It is double-sided currently, though. What I'm going to do is just move these vertices, basically, into the shape of an ear. So, if working in multiple layers, especially on parts that are going to attach onto other objects, you really need to go ahead and, in here in this menu, go to Inactive Meshes, and turn on, say, Flat Shade. Just to give yourself a little bit more distinction, that way it won't have the edges visible, things of that sort, so you get a distinction. But you know what your objects look like relative to one another. So back again to the sculpt tools and just start sculpting into place. You know, don't worry about tearing it up too much. And start pulling this you know, group of polygons into the shape of an ear, or you know, not really dynamic, not like it, no, not very realistic, I guess. Just a generic shape for the ear, particularly in respect to the orthographic views. Like for instance, here in front, this is useful, of course, because since we're in perspective mode, we have you know, some lens distortion, and this is the way that we're accustomed to kind of seeing a person, so it's kind of better than looking through the orthographic. But then come over here to the side, and the same thing. Get an idea of, you know what, I want the ear right here to kind of move forward a little bit more, and well, it's maybe going to tuck down, and then I guess actually that is the vertex that I want to have come back into the pointy area, because, well, this character is an elf. And you can kind of move your way around in multiple views, and you know, start off with a profile, go to a 3/4, and go to a front view, and see, you know, what's working for you in each view. There are also some nifty things you can do with Modo's viewports and setting up multiple cameras, so you have like certain views pre-set up, and that's very useful for actually trying to match references. If you have like some kind of photograph of a person at a front, you know, 3/4 inch profile. You can set it up so those cameras are kind of tweaked to fit those images, and then create something that, with lens distortion accounting for the original photographs, you can match up like an extremely accurate head. But that's for another much bigger, longer tutorial. As you can see, I'm just slowly tweaking into shape this ear, and I'm going to need a little bit more vertices on the top there to recreate the shape that I really want. Oops. Using the move tool, I mean the push tool, unfortunately. And now that I do want a little bit more detail at this point, being able to show how, in this case, my character's ears arch outwards. And he's going to be an old elf, so all the skin and flesh is going to be really hanging and sagging, affected by the many years of, you know, gravity. And once you got a shape that you like, start really focusing in on making sure it lines up with the side of your character's head well. You know, in the case of ear anatomy, try and look at your own ear. Also, just go on to, you know, Google image search, type in ears, you know, change it to a fairly high resolution image. You can get some great references for ears that way. But I'm going to do this without a reference to illustrate, you know, how you can just kind of feel it out inside of Modo. Alright, now we got a basic shape for the ear that I'm fairly happy with. In fact, I'm going to mirror that on over to the other side. And yeah, you know, turn symmetry on, make a few more adjustments, and I think we have a very good kind of mock-up of how the ear should look from the front and 3/4. And always keep in mind how fleshy ears are, and you know, how many interesting different planes and surfaces they actually have. All right, I'm happy with that for now, and I'm gonna go ahead and rename my layers now so that they're a little bit more descriptive, I guess. And let's see, rename. I'm gonna name that head, and I'm gonna rename that ears. Once again, real creative stuff. And I'm going to create a new layer. And I'm going to go back and rename the ears again, because actually, it's ears stand-in. And this is going to be your ears. So now we've got two meshes in the background. And we've got our head mesh and our ear kind of stand-in meshes. And we're going to begin to actually outline and create some of the major structures of the ear that we will then go in and start filling in with polys. And hopefully we'll be able to match that up with the polygon structure and count in our base mesh here. All right, now we're going to go on over to the model quad view. That includes the orthographic views. And we're going to go ahead and create another polygon. Now keep in mind at this point, whoops, I did not want to make that a cube. But keep in mind at this point, we don't really need to have all that much detail. I mean, look at this you know, mesh that it's going to be connecting to. It's going to be very simple. And all we want to do is start blocking out the shape and with very rectangular polygons as opposed to very square polys. Reason being is that we can just get it done a whole lot quicker and easier that way. And I just pressed the Z key for the edge extend tool, selected an edge, and pressed the Z key for edge extend, also located here in this menu, the Edge menu. Now what I'm going to do, and this is an important little workflow tip for using Modo as a modeler, because this works with virtually any of Modo's modeling tools. If you hold down the Shift key and then click in, I guess, pretty much any viewport, it will repeat your last action with a tool. And so, in this case, that was I used the Edge Extend tool, and it's a great way to keep your primary object highlighted, and also just keep on reusing a tool that, especially in this case, you are going to reuse a lot. And so, press the Shift key, pull down another edge, and if you'll notice, I'm moving around a lot between many different viewports. And the reason being is, you know, you want to get an idea of where your polygons are actually going. And just keep on swiveling around in your viewport. Alright. And once again, the Shift key to use the Edge Extend tool again. You know, so often with 3D modeling, it really comes down to how many clicks can you save. And that's one of the things that Modo's great at, is if you know, pay close attention to it, there's a lot of tools that have been added that are intended for you to be able to tailor methods of saving clicks. And I am a click fiend, just to let you know. I'm kind of a very twitchy modeler, may come from my extensive background as a first-person shooter gamer. Alright. Now, using some of the standard modeling tools, I can go in and kind of make some more adjustments. And since I've gotten this general outline shape, one of the things I want to do is start winding what is going to be the top of the ear here, these polys, this row of polys, and kind of start winding it on towards where the inner ear is going to be. At least in the case of my ear, that is how the flesh flows from up here and on into the ear. Obviously, many different ways it can do that depending upon, you know, person's anatomy. But generally, this is a good structure for creating a good base ear that you can then modify later at higher subdivision levels, because you'll just have good geometry for sculpting on top of. Alright, so I'm beginning to extend this structure into the location where the inner ear will be, and might as well start pulling it in already. And for this reason, I'm going to turn the ear stand-in off now, because really it's only going to get in the way of figuring out where this structure needs to go. And the Edge Extend tool again. It's maintaining its orientation on the edge really well with the local selection. Or local action center, excuse me. And just start creating the forms that move on towards the inner ear. Okay. I think now I want to push that in just a little bit further. And I would consider this right now at a very good point, in that we've already created, you know, a good amount of, I guess, structure on which we'll know better how to run polys. The way that this particular aspect of the ear winds its way on into the center will do a great job of directing us in how we create the connecting polys that actually produce the ear. And then also how we end up just kind of, I guess, thickening the ear, making some modifications to the back, and that way we're going to be able to get excellent subsurface effects because we're going to actually have an ear modeled the way that an ear is supposed to be, with the correct thickness of an ear, and once again producing excellent subsurface effects.